And good evening, gang. It's Tuesday, the 14th of March, 2017. Welcome along to today's United Kingdom talk, much later than usual, boys and girls. It's one of our late night specials. Oh, yes. A little bit of a chit chat late at night. I've been quite busy today. I've been to London and back on the train. And once again, I was tempted, boys and girls, on the way home. I didn't have such an early journey as I did last week. Do you remember that when I had to go to the hospital last week? 7:30 in the morning, I was at that station last week. Oh dear, not today, thank you. A very acceptable 10:15. And once again, I don't know why these people moan about the trains. They seem to work pretty well to me. Sorry, I haven't adjusted my collar. It's looking a bit unsmart, isn't it? Yeah, they seem to work pretty well with to me. 10:30 train, left at 10:32. Are they 2 minutes behind schedule? I mean, God's sake, man. That's not too bad. Got to Richmond Station, got off one train, crossed the platform, got on the other, which left 2 minutes later. You know, got to Hampstead Heath, done me stuff that I needed to do, got back out there, got on the train, got to Richmond. Now, the only thing is, when you get to Richmond Station, okay, if you're changing trains to use the toilet or any of the shops out there, you have to kind of leave the, I don't know what you would call it, the kind of ticketed area, the sort of ticketed area. So you've got to go back through the barrier. But it seems that if you've got an ongoing ticket, so change from London Overground, which I think is part of the Underground. It's all very, I don't know how it works, dear. It's all very complicated. You kind of get off the London Overground, I think it's the Silverlink train, and you cross over to Southwest Trains. Okay, now, to do that, you're kind of in an area, and to get into that area, you've got to put your ticket in the barrier, fair enough. But of course, to get out of the area, and the toilet is on the other side. I mean, it don't make sense. So you put your ticket in and, of course, it doesn't work. And then you have to say to the inspector or whoever's on the door, which is generally never a problem, really. You know, I need to go and use the toilet or I want to go to the shops, and he checks your ticket and he has to open the door manually. Well, it's a bit stupid, that, isn't it? Why can't we just, you know, what if I was desperate? You know how it is, ladies and gentlemen. Sometimes you're desperate to get to that toilet and then you've got to ask someone, you know, probably while you're standing, and then you wet yourself. I mean, terrible. And then no doubt someone would complain and they'd start moaning and out would come the mop and all that. I mean, God knows I have to go downstairs and clear my, keep cleaning my kitchen floor. Oh, the cat, dear, I'm sorry. Katie the cat, you know, regular viewers to the show will know Katie the cat. She will make an appearance as always on our end. I think, is she on the end video? Oh, I don't know if she is now. I'm not sure if she's on the end video or not. Oh, I can't remember. Anyway, Katie the cat, yeah, she's 18 years old now. I think about 18 years old. And I'm afraid she's losing control very fast now. And she's no longer making it to the cat tray at all. If you watch the show regular, you'll know that half of my kitchen floor is now covered in newspapers. Now, I'm getting through a lot of newspapers now, which was a good job I went into town today because they give away the Metro free of charge. Oh, yes. And I had a rucksack with me and I filled that rucksack up with Metro newspapers today. I must be getting through a newspaper a day now because she's not actually making it to the cat tray at all. Sad, isn't it, really? Now, she used to make it to the cat tray for wee's, but not to the cat tray for poos. I mean, I can't work that. She would poo on the floor in the kitchen. And you're forever cleaning the floor. Because, you know, you've got to do it. You can't just scrape it up. Oh, no, dear. Got to get the mop out. So what I did some weeks ago was cover half of the area that she kept doing the pooing in on the kitchen floor with newspapers. Usually my free copy of the Daily Mail from Waitrose. But I'm not getting enough newspapers. That's the trouble. Now, she's not making the, let me just get rid of that phone over there. That's annoying me. Now, she's not actually making it for wee's to the litter tray at all. And I don't know why, because like there's an area of newspaper. And so she's going in on the newspaper, which kind of makes it easier because it does soak up the water. you know, there's like a layer of two or three newspapers, but then you have to gather up so much newspaper and replace it all. And I'm running out of newspapers. So as I say, you know, on the way to Hampstead Heath today, to the I went to the Royal Free Hospital today. On my way there, I picked up a load of Metro newspapers and put them in. Well, you'd think that would be easy. You know, when you get the Daily Mail or the Sun or the Telegraph, you know, I can't be reading those great big newspapers, dear. Have you seen them on the trains trying to read one of those big newspapers? And they're like, oh, God, you know, and oh, no. What an, whoever had the idea of having newspapers that size? Thank God they made them in small tablet form, dear. They go all over the place. You know, and you're sitting next to someone there and like, you can't see the people on it. There might be a fit lad sitting on the chair over there. You can't see him because some bonzo has got his blooming newspaper open, hasn't he? Dear, dear me. Anyway, the Metro, you would think it would be the same like that. So this morning, I got back in. I left the house at 9:45 this morning and I got back in I got back in here at about 4:45 because I stopped at my mate's house on the way. Now, my mate should be on holiday at the moment, but I'll tell you about that. He's not. He's at home at the moment. I'll tell you about that a little bit later on. So I got back in the house at about 4:45 and as usual, you know, little area of newspapers soaking wet where she's had a wee, you know, so off comes the coat. We don't complain. We don't complain. We don't moan because she can't help it. She's elderly. Possibly some of you are having trouble holding your liquids in at the moment as well, are you, lovers? Eh? Just sometimes not quite make it to the toilet. You do, don't you? Oh, especially those of you with IBS, the same as me. Oh, that's very difficult to make it to that toilet on time. Anyway, so I scraped up the newspapers, you know, put them in the bin, washed my hands twice, and then I got my copy of one of the copies of the Metro. I thought, oh, this is fantastic, you know. And then I start trying to... They've put a staple in the middle, dear. Oh, why do they put staples in newspapers? So, of course, you've ripped the paper. Well, it's no good ripped, is it? They put staples in the blooming newspapers. How annoying is that? You know, so now you've got to go into the middle and rip one off carefully and rip another one off carefully. Oh, what? Why do they put staples in the Metro? None of the other paper, they don't need it in there, do they? It's just make my life awkward. That's what it's about. It's to make my... Someone in the Metro says, watch out for that Chris Reardon. He's going to go to the tube, to the train station today and collect some copies of the Metro to put down for his cat. We'll put a staple in there to make it more difficult for him. That's what's going on there. What a liberty, dear. What else am I supposed to do? Now, of course, I know those Metro newspapers are up at the station, I should go daily now and get a few more copies. Every time I run, I'm not buying newspapers, dear. No, not if they're free. Just go up to the station and nick a few while you're up there. Well, years ago, of course, when I was in the Scouts, Cubs, do your best. I promise to do my honour to God and the Queen to help other people and to keep the Scout law. Yes, be prepared. When I was in the Scouts, we used to collect newspapers to make money. We would collect all these newspapers in and then sell them to some newspaper, I don't know what they used to do, recycling. Because in those days, of course, I'm going back here to the 70s and the 80s, in those days, recycling was unheard of. You just used to put it all in a bin and someone used to come and collect it up and put it in a hole somewhere. Well, we've run out of holes there. It all has to be recycled. I don't know if you can get money for newspapers now, but literally in this Scout hut, a corner, it must have taken up, I suppose, 6 foot by 6 foot. The corner of the Scout hut was completely full up from top to bottom with newspapers. We got a call coming in here. Hello, Danny. Did you used to collect newspapers in the Scouts?
I didn't, because I never did Scouts, love.
Oh, and why is that then? Were you too camp to be a Scout?
I never had the chance. Well, I never had.
Are you drunk, dear?
Say again.
You sound a bit drunk tonight.
I'm in a pub and I'm speaking to you.
Well,
I'm
I can hear that. You are slurring a little bit, dear.
I'm in my pub.
Oh, have you got me on in the pub? I hope people aren't watching me in there. I will not be put on in Weatherspoon's pubs. I thank you very much.
I don't work in with the spoons, love.
Oh, right, okay. How can I help you tonight, Danny, while you're interrupting my story, even before my phone lines have been opened to the millions of people watching today?
We're talking about the whole kind of thing about the Brexit.
Well, no, I'm not talking about that.
But I will be.
Well, why not? We're not talking about Brexit. This is not that show. This is not a political show, dear. Have you been paying attention to anything that I've been saying in the last 10 minutes? No, I thought not.
I thought Brexit.
Goodbye. Thank you very much. Dear me. I mean, what's the point? What is the point? We are not talking about Brexit, are we? What is the point in sitting here chatting away with these and someone calls in with something completely indifferent, completely random, full of politics? Do I look like I do politics on here? You know, I don't know what way you swing. I don't care, as long as you're still there at the end of the day. Now, as I was saying, yes, so we used to collect these papers, and I think they actually used to make quite a lot of money out of that, but not now. You know, of course, the council's collect all this stuff, and I have a blue recycling bin outside for my cardboard and my plastics and my newspapers, dear. Thank you very much. Yes, and my green bin for my household rubbish, including cat litter, which is hardly being used. What, the cat litter has now been replaced by wrapped up pieces of paper. The Metro, which I nicked from the train station down the road. So could you do me a favour? If you're coming along to any of the karaoke nights that I do, as you well know, or the quiz night tomorrow, could you bring me in your unwanted newspapers? Because, Katie, this is an appeal, boys and girls. It is an appeal. Now, usually at this point on the telly, a little number will flash up at the bottom of the screen saying, appeal. This is an appeal. Please, could you bring in your used newspapers to wherever I am working over the coming few weeks so that I've got enough for Katie the cat to continue weeing wherever she wants to wee without having the long, arduous journey of about 6 feet to go to the cat litter tray. Thank you very much. This will be most helpful. Anyway, so going back to the station, so you can't actually leave the station without getting permission, you know, and a bloke pushes a button on this disabled gate. The gate itself isn't disabled. The gate for disabled people opens, and for people with large prams and that sort of thing. And you go through there and go to the toilet or the pasty shop. Mmm, yum, yum, yum. Now, you know, last Monday I did the same thing, so I walked through there. So I went to the toilet. This is on the way home. And the pasty, and then I went to the pasty shop and I had cheese and veg pasty and a veg pasty. No, cheese and onion pasty, a veg pasty and a cup of tea. You know, £10.65. God. And they smile at you when they take the money. And then he weren't happy with that. He said, oh, would you like some of our wedges as well? No, thank you. Are you sure they're very nice? No! It's already cost me £10.65. I mean, very nice. I can't lie to you. They are big pasties in there. Now, Greg's pasties. Nothing wrong with Greg's pasties, except there's no Greg's in there. That's all there is. I think it's the Cornish pasty shop, something like that. So I sat down there, took my time eating that. Very nice. I love to watch people. Don't you watch people? Don't you watch me? There was some woman on today, on the television today. I don't know if you might have seen her on my Facebook wall already, representing something to do with the SNP in Scotland. And it cut to a pic. Oh, she looked like the Loch Ness Monster. Did you see her? She looked like the Loch Ness Monster. I was scared watching that woman. Scared. Scared. Yes. So I had that. Then I finished. I said thank you to the man, took my plate over. And then I crossed the bridge because you have to go upstairs, across, and then down to platform one at Richmond Station. Now, the train standing at platform one is calling to Reading, calling at Twickenham, Martinshaven, Bracknell, Ascot, Sunningdale. Now, Sunningdale, now there's a lovely place. Oh! Sunningdale. And actually, the houses are around about the same price as they are here, which surprised me. It's very, very rural. Sunningdale. Beautiful place to live. So I'm crossing there, and now I'm standing, I'm looking at the clock, and it's about 6 minutes to go. And while I'm standing there, quietly minding my own business, observing the people, well, I'm not joking yet, it must be an entire school that then came down the stairs, all in their little uniforms, and teachers, which, I'll be honest with you, didn't look much older than the children. You know? And so, there was a teacher there, I noticed, and he had this flowery shirt on. I mean, God's sake, man, a teacher with no tie, no jacket, just this flowery shirt and something hanging round his neck. These teachers are, no wonder they don't get any respect anymore and people are throwing chairs at them. When you wear shirts like that for school, you should have a suit on. When I went to school, London Oratory in Fulham, we had suits there. They all had suits and ties, and you would not dare say a word out of place because you would be lashed over the speaker. It would come. You'd get that click. Here is an announcement. Would Reardon from 1MS please report the front entrance? No, it wouldn't say please. It wouldn't say please. I'll do it again. Here is an announcement. Would Reardon from 1MS report to the front entrance hall now? And you know what that meant? We would get the cane. Yes, I got it twice. After that, I started asking for it and they wouldn't give it to me after that. But never mind. Some people pay to be caned. Do you know that? Oh, yes. Very strange people, dear. Strange and mysterious people enjoy being caned. Perhaps you're one of them. It's OK. We're all friends here. Don't worry about that. If you like the cane, nothing to do with me what you do in your own spare time. So as I say, an entire school came down the stairs and took up, my God, at least half the platform, and they're long platforms here. And it was quite funny. As the time of the train approached, because they got this little tick over clock thing, that's, you know, 10, I don't know what time it was, like 2:33, 1 second, 2 seconds, and it counts up all the time. And as the time to the claim was getting closer, I noticed everyone else, including myself, were trying to move to parts of the platform that the children didn't appear to be taking up. Oh, they were noisy. They were so noisy. But it was fantastic. It actually created a wonderful atmosphere on that platform. I love the trains. I love the trains, and I much prefer to get a train into London if I ever have to go into London during the daytime. It's so much more fun. You know, you just sit there and you kind of, you know, you mustn't put your feet on the chairs. That's very naughty. On the way there, I decided to sit in the quiet section, and there's some girl on the phone, dear. Chat, chat, chat. It says quiet, dear. But you don't say anything to them. Because they'll shout something out, won't they? They'd just be rude and start swearing at you. It says quiet zone. One girl on her phone. Another bloke, he had the headphones on. Oh, that's all I could hear. Coming out of these headphones all the time. I'm sitting there quietly trying to read my book, Radio Boy. And I'm here. I've got to there. Look, I've read. That's the first time I've read. I think it's one of the first, possibly the first time I've ever read a book so quickly. I am loving this book. A little bit more about that later on. So got back on the train, and then on the way there, I rang my mate, and I said, "I'll pop round for a cup of tea." So I did that on the way home. I got back here around about 4:45. Changed the cat's newspaper downstairs and went straight to bed because I was so tired. It was a long day for me. 4:45. And then I woke up. Now, I've got two chiming clocks in here in the house. There's one in the living room and the one that used to be here in the Mirable Studio. Is that turning? Yes, it is. The one that used to be here in the Mirable Studio is now downstairs in the hall. And the chime is quite loud. So if you're in bed, it chimes the quarter, the half, the three quarters, and on the hour. So sometimes you wake up and you hear the chime, dun, 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 and you hope it's going to be the full tune so that then you'll get the hour chime and then you won't have to you won't have to open your eyes and look at the clock. You know, I'm kind of half asleep and I'm hearing this chime, dun, 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 dun. And then it just stopped. Oh, damn, it's the quarter of an hour. Never mind, you know, I'll lay around in bed and wait for the next one. But I'll probably drift off. And then you wake up again and it'll go, dun, 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 dun. And if it's only a quarter of an hour, then you know an hour has passed again. But you don't know what hour, you know. And I was lying in bed and it started, you know. Dun, 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 dun. Dun, 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 dun. Dun, 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 dun. Dun, 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 dun. And I thought, ah, yes, I'm going to find out. It's probably about 6 or 7 o'clock now. Dun, 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 dun. I thought, 8 o'clock? And I turned on my light and looked over, and it was 8 o'clock. So I'd been asleep for like nearly 4 hours, 5, 6, 7, 8, well, 3 hours. So I don't know where that went. That's a, so I did say to you this afternoon when I did my little preview video, we're doing preview videos now to warn you that there is a show coming up later because I don't want you to miss anything. I might be giving something away for all you know. Last week, if you had been watching last week, you would have seen someone win a car, someone win a holiday in Barbados, someone win a holiday in the Isle of Wight. We give away stuff left, right and centre. You've got to be here all the time. To, and it's no use crying. You know, oh, I missed it. Have you got any? It's like the mugs. Do you remember the mugs we gave away? I've got one here somewhere. Where is it? Oh, there it is here. That's my one. Remember the mugs we gave away? So I mentioned them at the end of one of the shows and we gave them all away. And then days later, when I was talking about, oh, can I have a mug, please? No, they've all gone. No, they've all gone, dear. You know, it's like Jesus says in the Bible, isn't it? You know, you've got to stay awake all the time waiting for him to come again, dear. If you fall asleep, then you've missed your opportunity. That's what happened with the mugs. There they all were. Oh, can I have a mug, please, Chris? No, you missed a show, dear. Only for regular viewers and listeners. That's it. Oh, I'm so naughty sometimes, aren't I? So, as I say, I got up about 8 o'clock. I intended to be on with you about 9, but that didn't happen, did it, really? So now it's 20 to 10 in here, 20 to 11 now. How long have I been talking for? 40 minutes. Where does the time go? Where does the time go? I can't believe I've been in chat for 40 minutes and haven't even opened the phone lines yet. So that's been my day so far. And I've had a nice day. Thank you very much. Very nice day indeed. Let's do some of your messages coming through this morning then. And then we'll open the phone lines. I've got a few little bits and pieces for you to talk about tonight. And there's no rush, really, you know. Could go past an hour tonight. I wish I'd brought in a glass of water. I might have to get a cup of water from my from the bathroom. I don't usually like to drink, but my friend Adam the plumber says you shouldn't drink water out of the bathroom tap because it's, you know, it comes from a tank and there's all sorts of nasties up there. Evilness in your evilness in your water tank could be hiding there. It could. Hello to Darren Taylor Nowney. Hello, Darren. All right, sir. Nice to see you. Adam. Oh, Adam the plumber is with us this evening. Good evening, Adam. Ashley's there. Dino's there. Hello, Dino. It's been a while, sir. Hello, Dino. Lee Cobby. Hello. I need to pop down and sing karaoke. You need to come, Lee, and sing karaoke. By the way, when you're coming to karaoke, please bring me your old newspapers. One will do. If everyone bought one newspaper, Katie the cat would have plenty of space to keep weeing to her heart's content on my kitchen floor. Hello, Lee. Shania on the Isle of Wight's with us today. Rod Brown. Hello, Rod. John Childe says, evening from Lower Greenwich. What do you mean, Lower Greenwich? What does that mean, Lower Greenwich? Is that like the posh part of Greenwich or the so-called posh part? Is that what it is, John? Lower Greenwich, dear. It's like my mate who lives in Bracknell. He calls it South Ascot. No, it's not. It's Bracknell. It's Bracknell, love. It's not South Ascot. People in Battersea don't live in South Chelsea. They live in Battersea. That's it. Thank you, John. Lee says, I look smart today. Thank you, Lee. I do try and dress up a little bit for the show. I actually walk around town like a tramp. I seriously. Hello to Graham. Says, does the cat read newspapers? No, she just wheezes on them, Graham. She just wheezes on newspapers, I'm afraid, Graham. Hello to George Knight. Hello, George. Been a while, sir. Terry Turner's there. Greetings, Christopher. Would you like a jelly baby? Oh, no, dear. No sweets for Lent. We must give up things. It was a bit late now. You should have given up something for Lent, Terry. Any moment now, a thunderbolt will come down and strike you dead. Be very careful. Perhaps it's not too late. It's not too late. give up something for Lent. What did you give up for Lent today, boys and girls? Or what have you given up for Lent since Lent started? That is, thank you, Terry, for leading me on to a question, which is perfect to open the phone lines. There we go. Phone lines are now open. Operators are standing by to accept your call, boys and girls. A number has miraculously appeared in front of you on your video screens. Those of you watching on tiny little smartphones somewhere secretly. Are you watching secretly? Huh? Are you at work somewhere? Are you at work and you've kind of got the phone under the table like that and you're watching me like that? Is that what's happening? Are you a secret viewer? Well, wherever you are, have you given up anything for Lent? And what was it? Is it hard? Is it hard? Are you suffering, boys and girls? Are you suffering? Are you suffering Lent? As you should be. You need to suffer. You need to suffer. What have you given up for Lent that has made you suffer? Your opportunity to ring in and tell me tonight. 020-8144-3477. It's a local London number. It's a normal phone number. It is not a premium rate number. You know, 0901. Oh, hi. Babestation, can I help you? Oh, hi. Have you seen those women on Babestation? God's sake, no wonder no one calls them. Dear me, this is not a Babestation number. This is a local London number. If you want to call in, if you don't want to call in, that's fine as well. No problem with that, okay? 020-8144-3477. There's also a Skype in. If you're viewing this programme globally, if you're watching from another planet, you can still call in if you've got Skype. And my Skype in is all one word, United Kingdom Talk. That's a Skype in, United Kingdom Talk. Or indeed the phone number, 020-8144-3477. What have you given up for Lent? What did you forget? It's not too late. You can give up something tonight with me. I've done sweets, chocolate, crisps and bread. Except bread on Mondays and Fridays when the lovely is that delectable? Is that the word? Delectable? I don't know if that's the right word. What does delectable mean? Just a moment, please. Delectable. Just a moment, please. I don't want to use the wrong words. I don't want to be accused of calling someone something. Just a moment, please. Delectable. Detonation. Demonstrative. Decker. Delivery room. Delight. Delete. Delete. Delaunay? What the hell's that? Delaware. Delectable. Greatly pleasing, especially to the sense of taste. Enjoyable. Yes, the delectable. Beautiful Maureen brings me in sandwiches on Mondays and Fridays, and she enjoys making them, so that's why I still eat bread on Mondays and Fridays. But apart from that, that's what I gave up for Lent. What did you give up for Lent? You haven't, have you? Oh, my Lord. Straight to hell, I'm afraid, for you, my loves. Straight to hell. You need to suffer. 020-8144-3477 is the number. Graham says, my dog did mess and I had to put papers down its bow that goes. What? My dog did mess and I had to put papers down its the bow that goes. Oh, I'm sorry. Well, the same thing's happened to me, to be honest, Graham, as you well know. If you watch the show regularly, you'll know. A terrible trouble with mine. Although, I gotta say, since the antibiotics I had 2 weeks ago, problem seems to be cleared up. I wonder if I've had an infection down there somewhere, and it's been there for a year and a half. God knows why it hasn't eaten away at the inside of my stomach. Graham goes on to say, my dog was 18 years old. Your cat being 18 times 7 cat years, it means she is now equivalent to 126 years old in human years. And she goes on and on. She ain't ready to peg out yet, dear. Oh, no, she does like to be picked up and cuddled, my cat. She loves it. And she starts purring. And I think one of the things you look at with animals, if they are still getting pleasure by being touched up, by being touched, then I think, you know, it's not time. I think if they're in terrible distress or pain and there's nothing to be done, then that's a different thing altogether, don't you? I reckon so. All right, let's just carry on with these little messages coming through here. John says you need a staple remover.
I need a staple remover for those Metro newspapers.
John says after three bottles of wine, you are going to the toilet every 10 minutes. I'm sure you are.
I'm sure you are, John. I've noticed that you go to the toilet quite a lot when we're doing karaoke nights.
Rude it is.
How would you like it if people went to the toilet every time you started singing a song?
Adam's going to bring me some newspapers, Adam.
Paul said he used to cane guys. Did you really? Were you a teacher as well?
Nothing wrong with a bit of caning.
I tell you, once you got caned at school, you didn't do that again, did you?
Absolutely not.
Rachel says now I like a bit of rough. I expect you to, Rachel.
I mean, just look at this.
This is what you call a bit of rough, dear.
Rod said, I got canes most days, including my very last day, but thank you for the schooling I received.
Yeah, me too, Rod.
Honestly, we didn't have people throwing things and that sort of thing.
John says I'm going to give up smoking. Just paid £160 for a vaping machine and had to pay extra for the batteries, another £30, then £25 for juice.
Can't you make your own juice?
Dear me.
So there we are.
Okay, we've got another call coming in. Who's on the line now, please?
He had to pay what? What were you just saying?
Oh, just a minute now. Oh, it's my friend Ron. Hello, Ron.
Best friend.
Just a minute. Hello, best friend. Just a minute.
Thank you.
Oh, it says I am echoing, Chris. Was I echoing? Ah. Okay, just a moment. I need to just change something. Can you hold a second?
Is that the reverb?
No, I see what I've done. Just a moment. I've got to just change something here. One second.
One minute.
Shut up. I'm not saying anything.
No, that doesn't work.
Okay, it's all right. So I've gone back to what I was doing now.
Hello.
Now, what was I saying? Oh, about someone paying out. This bloke's trying to give up smoking. He's paid £160 for a vaping machine. Is that what they are?
They're just as bad.
Speak into the phone.
They are just as bad.
Oh, £160 for a vaping machine, extra for the batteries, another £30 for the batteries, and £25 for the juice that you put in it.
They're not safe either. When you charge them up, they can explode.
Oh, can they? Like a Samsung Galaxy phone?
Yes, and those things that got two wheels that you can go around on.
What are they?
You know those two? The little hoverboards.
Hoverboards.
Things.
My nephew had one of those, Jimmy Butler. He was very good at it. I fell flat on my face. Never mind.
Do you feel flat on your...
Flat on my face.
Oh, no, dear. More like your backside.
I don't...
But anyway...
Did I go backwards? Hello, Ron. How are you tonight?
Hello. It's me. Yes, it's your best friend.
I was just sitting there.
I was watching a programme and doing bits as I'm going on holiday tomorrow. And then I looked at the time and thought, oh, God, I bet I've missed him. And then you've been on for an hour and a half, dear.
I haven't been on for an hour and a half.
Haven't you really?
No, about 55 minutes, including the countdown as well.
Ah, well, I didn't take into consideration the countdown.
Ah.
So I thought I'd give you a little call just before I was just about to talk about...
Your holiday, because I said just earlier on in the show, on the way back from the hospital today, I popped in at your house, although you should be on holiday. Now, you were supposed to go to New York today, weren't you? What's happened?
Well, we had because of the snowstorm, they changed out. Well, they told us that the flight was cancelled. Right. Then they tried to put us on another flight on Thursday. Right. But we're going to St. Patrick's Day, which is on Friday.
Hail, glorious St. Patrick, dear saint of our...
It just kind of snowballed from there. But it's ended up that now we're actually flying tomorrow at 4 o'clock.
In the morning?
No, in the afternoon. The chauffeur's picking us up at 12.
Is it chauffeur?
We're going to go straight into the club because we're flying upper class.
Right.
We're going to go straight into the clubhouse. You get your own private lane. So
yes.
there's cars that can drive into this lane and cars that can't, and we're one of the ones that can. And it swings around, and it's completely separate from all other parts of the airport.
Right.
It's got its own security channel and everything, and it takes you straight into the clubhouse. So they're going to have a bit of lunch, and they've got a hairdresser's in there, so I'm going to get my hair cut and have my beard
done. You only had it done on Friday. How many times do you need to get your hair cut?
It's in the if you look on the Virgin.
Yeah, but how many times do you have to get your hair cut in a week? You only had it done Friday.
Yeah, but my beard could do with a bit of a trim.
Oh, you've got one of those beards again. Yeah, I forgot about that.
I've got to look. Oh, look, when I shaved it off, you didn't even notice.
I did notice. I can't be doing with those. I mean, yours isn't, to be honest, yours isn't as bad as some of them. Hanging down in their blooming soup and things like that. I mean, it's not that bad. But, you know, oh, he's gone, lost him. I think I've lost Ronny. That's cut out. Try again. We've lost him. It'll probably come back to us. We're waiting for that call to come back through there. Rachel says, very nice mugs they are too. Thank you, Rachel. There he is. He's back again. There we are. Hello.
I don't know what happened there.
Well, it's your phone, isn't it? It's those iPhone 7 Plus. Is it an 8 Plus? What is it? 7 Plus.
An iPhone 7 Plus.
7 Plus. Well, carry on anyway.
Yeah, no, it's not my phone. It's not my phone. It's just probably something with the network or something. You know, these things happen. It's not the fault.
It's not the systems here in the Mirrorball studio, darling. This is top quality equipment here.
Okay, I'm not going to go down that route.
Good.
So we'll have a little haircut. There's a spa. And there's a bar where you can have cocktails mixed and you can have dinner and all lovely things.
Right.
So we'll spend the afternoon there and then we jump onto our plane, turning left, and we can have a little snooze because it's got lay flat beds. And
how
then,
long is the flight to
the
New York?
We'll be in New York.
Is it 6 hours?
No, 8 hours, 10 minutes.
Oh, it's 8 hours. Now, why did I think it was six? I thought it was 6 hours to there.
I don't know.
Oh, well.
Maybe on all those economy short-haul trips that you do, you thought it was one of those.
I don't do them anymore, dear. I gave up flying. I hate it. I can't stand it.
Yes, I know.
Can't bear it. Hate it. Even in the posh seats. Can't stand it. Gets on my nerves. Mucking around at airport. Some snotty thing on the passport control. Checking out your picture. And I can't bear it. Oh,
well,
it's so inconvenient
in this,
flying.
In this thing that they do. It's very good. It's very good. There's none of that in what we're doing.
I might do a cruise again. I might like to do a cruise at some point. You drive to the ship and walk on. That's it, I think. I mean, I suppose they've got some sort of passport control there.
That's the one where you go from Southampton.
Yes.
Yes, that would be nice. That's a very enjoyable experience.
I wonder how long it takes to sail to, like, could you sail to Florida?
Yes, of course you can. You can fly. You can cruise across the Atlantic.
Can you?
They do boats that cruise across the Atlantic and do American tours.
Sail to Florida. Let's have a little look. Sailing to Florida. Is there a cheap way to sail to America? How long does it take?
Well, unless you're on a row.
P&O cruises. North America. It is North America, isn't it? Florida, is it? I don't know.
It's on the West Coast. But yeah, it is North America because it's on the West Coast. But also, do you remember earlier I told you I thought I saw something on my credit card?
Oh, yes, yes.
It was another hotel that I booked for our next holiday.
Well, when's the next one?
We're off to Santorini.
Ooh?
And then on to Cyprus. Santorini, Greece.
Can you just carry on talking a minute? I need to find a tissue.
Yeah.
Tell us about Santorini and Greece. Carry on.
Santorini is beautiful. It is so picturesque. It's like a mountain, and it's got beautiful little white houses painted with the blue, and it's gorgeous. And Andy's always wanted to go there, so I think we're going to do that, and then go on to Cyprus to meet my brother. My brother, Danny Irvin, the taxi driver, the very good taxi driver, very, very good taxi driver. One of the best taxi drivers in London. But then again, I'm a bit biased saying that, aren't I? But yeah, so my trip to New York, funny though, our flight was cancelled, but my mother's wasn't.
Oh, so she's there. What time is she there then?
So she's there. She's there. They left and I think she's there now.
Oh.
So, or she should nearly be there. So I don't understand
how they let that plane go and yet not yours. That don't make sense to me. I've seen the news of the stuff in New York. I've seen the weather and that. It looks horrific, and I don't think it's stopped yet.
My mother was flying Delta, so they probably wanted their plane back, because why their plane's over here, it's losing money.
Oh, right.
So they take the risk. Have their plane back over there, even if they divert them to, I don't know, Miami or something, or Detroit, they would have their plane back, and then they would only have to put up the passengers for so long until the weather clears up and it works out cheaper. Oh. You know, I think it's something like £10,000 an hour if a plane's on the ground.
Is it really? Gosh.
It's something ridiculous like that.
That's why they like to keep them up in the air, don't they? Like to keep them up in the air as much as possible.
Absolute fortune.
Well, I hope you've got a good man working on the maintenance on your one, dear. We don't want any accidents, my love.
Well, there won't be, because I'm flying upper class. You don't even get turbulence in upper, do you?
Do you not?
No, of course not.
I will laugh my head off if you ring up from America and say, I've broken my arm because there was a sudden bit of turbulence and you happen to be standing up with a glass of orange juice.
Oh, no, not me, dear. I fall asleep. You know what I'm like? I get on a plane, I fall asleep.
Same as me.
Before the plane's even taken off, I fall asleep.
I hate it. I hate sitting there. I'm so bored on a plane. You have 200 TV channels, every film under the sun, and I'm sitting there bored to tears. What we need is the facility to do broadcasts from a plane. I'll be happy then. Well, I can sit there and talk for the whole 8 hours.
A lot of the planes now have Wi-Fi.
Oh, well, maybe you can do that now. Maybe I could actually do a show from the plane. Do you think the other people gathered around, you know, would complain at the noise emanating from my seat?
Well, I don't have a seat. I have a pod.
Oh, it's the same thing. Seat, pod, whatever it is, dear.
It's like your own. It's like your own room.
Right.
If you go onto the Virgin Atlantic website.
What now?
And have a look. Have a look at the different. You've got economy.
Right.
Which smells. Then you've got premium economy.
We haven't got time. Don't think you're better than everyone else. Don't think you're better than everyone else sitting on a plane like that.
I don't think I'm better than anybody else.
Well, that's how it
sounds. Same as you. If I have to go on a plane for a certain amount of time, I want to be comfortable. It's not about being better than. And listen, we all defecate, burp, and fart. We're all the same.
Defecate.
Well, I don't want to say the rude word. Awful word.
We've done the whole pool thing. I'm afraid we've done the poo thing already.
Well, no, if I was to say shite, you would.
No, we don't like that. We don't like that word on this family programme, thank you.
See? That's why I said defecate. But we're all the same. No one's better and no one's any worse than me.
Right.
And that's how it is.
Well, have a lovely flight tomorrow, and I hope your thing takes off on time and everything all right, dear?
Well, I'll probably speak to you in the morning. As I say, the car's picking us up about 11:45.
Are you going up the swimming pool tomorrow?
Am I going what?
You going swimming tomorrow morning then?
No. I've still got packing and stuff to do. Last minute bits tomorrow morning, and then I'll speak to you, and then we'll be on our way, and then I'll give you a little FaceTime from the clubhouse.
Okay, cheerio then.
Okay, I'll speak to you in the morning.
Thanks
goodbye,
for calling.
Goodbye, everybody.
Bye-bye to our millions of people. Say goodbye. Millions. Journey. Millions. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
There we are, Ronny, off on a holiday tomorrow to New York. I bet you wish you were going to New York, don't you, eh? Huh? Wouldn't you love to be there? In that cold? I don't think so. Cold. But he's never been, so he's got that to experience, you see. And the last time I went to New York was 2 years ago? It was 4 years ago. It was for my 50th birthday. And you'll think it's a silly reason I went. I mean, I went to see the Barry Manilow concert. Who was on there at that particular time. But it tied in nicely with my 50th birthday. And I had a feeling someone was going to throw a surprise birthday party for me. And I can't handle it. I can't handle surprises like that. I really can't. And I don't know what to do and what to say. And I get really shy and embarrassed. So that's one of the reasons I went away from my 50th birthday party. So no one could throw a surprise party. And anyway, when I was there, I went in February. It was a little bit earlier than it is now. February the 5th was around the time I went. And it, oh my God, it was so cold. I've never been so cold in my life. And by the look of it, that's how it is there now. So he's got that cold to experience there. And it's, you know, it's okay. I mean, you've got to go out with a woolen hat. I left, literally, as the doors opened on this hotel, I stepped outside and my ears froze instantly. It was that cold. New York's got to be one of the coldest places in the world. It really has when it's cold. So he's had a little bit of a disaster at the moment. Who's on that phone now? Just a minute now. Hello? Sorry? Oh, you're on the home phone now. There's so many methods of communication. Thank you so much. Goodbye. Thank you. phones all over the place in here. Oh, it is a hive of activity today. A hive of activity. Yes, so a bit of a disaster to start the holidays, but it'll be on his way tomorrow and I'm sure it'll be all right. I'm just looking at the weather on the telly and I'm thinking, my God, that still looks pretty bad to me. I wouldn't want to be going and it will be freezing, freezing cold. So that's like a minor disaster. And I was going to come around to that. Have you had any holiday disasters? Or maybe something that just went a little bit wrong and it went all right in the end? Any holiday disasters have you had? Or perhaps, you know, you went somewhere, I don't know, and the front wheel of your car fell off, or the plane got stuck for like 10 hours somewhere. There's nothing worse than plane delays, is there? I mean, admittedly, I think the airlines have got better at it and they tend to ring people now if a plane is going to be delayed and they've got a phone. I mean, obviously, they've got to have a phone number for you. But I think now they ring people. Indeed, Ronny was telling me earlier that they rung his mum and told her there was a 4-hour delay, so not to come to the airport for another 4 hours. The worst place to be hanging around an airport for 4 hours. God, it's boring. And those shops, I mean, the shop in and out those shops, you know, no VAT. I swear those shops put the prices up, you know, to cover the fact and make the extra 15% themselves. There's no, it's not really interesting going around shops in airports. I don't think it is. And, you know, oh, we can have a meal. Well, that only takes about half an hour. Even quicker for me, the way I stuffed my face. I mean, how many meals can you have in 4 hours? So have you had any holiday disasters? You want to tell me about them tonight? You can call in 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. 020-8144-3477. Or you can Skype in on the Skype in number United Kingdom Talk. A line has become available. All the lines are available, to be honest. 020-8144-3477 for your holiday experience. Or maybe you've had a good holiday experience. I've had some wonderful holidays. I'll come to those in a minute. Let's just do some messages coming up there. Hello to Alan Russell. Hello, Alan, who's with us today. Greetings, Alan. Welcome. Hello to John again, who says, what is the best phone to have? An old black... I've got an... What is the best phone to get? Have an old BlackBerry at the moment. I'm on EE. They are offering an iPhone 5 or an iPhone 5S, only £6 difference, or a friend of mine has an iPhone 6S on the 3 network, but wants £150 for it. Okay, John. I was on Orange, which became EE for years, and I mean years, about 20 years. I never had a problem with them, really. And the reason I changed, I'm now on the 3 network. And the only reason I changed onto the 3 network was because they did unlimited data. As you know, I stream most of the karaoke nights that I do now. And that gets through quite a lot of data. My contract with EE was up for renewal. And I just started doing these video shows and I kept running out of data. So I rang them up and I said, I need more data. And I think I had about 5 gigs worth of data. Well, how much do you need? As much as possible. 3 are offering unlimited. Oh, John's on the phone now. Hello, John. How are you? All right. John? Hello, John?
Hello.
Oh, there you go. Gotcha. Hello, John. All right.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes. Well, we can hear you. Can't you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Ah, there you are. Hello, John. What's up?
Yes, I'm just phoning up about holiday disasters.
Ah, yes, holiday. I was just talking to you about your phone thing there.
Yes, I know, because I was just hearing that just as I was calling you.
Do you want me
I've
to...
got about 2 minutes delay.
Oh, shall I tell you the phone thing first, or shall we go to the holiday first? I can't decide. I'll do the phone
thing. Go to the home first.
I'll do the phone thing first for you. Yeah so please. Stay there. It's only a London number. Don't worry about it. It's not expensive at all. Yeah, so I knew that Three were offering their unlimited data, unlimited minutes and unlimited texts for 30 quid a month. And I thought, that's a good deal. And I thought, but I'll ring EE first, because you want to stay with the same people, really, because you know the network, don't you?
Of
you know
course,
what I mean?
Of course you do, yeah.
Once you, if you're with EE, you know where you're going to get cut off because you're used to that network now. Anyway, so I must have spent 45 minutes twice on the phone to two different people at Orange, at EE. And they said, what do you want? I said, well, I want unlimited data. Well, we can't do that. What we can offer you is... Da, 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 da. And I said, well, Three's offering me unlimited data. Can you match that? No. Well, I'm afraid I'm going to have to leave you there. Then they put you through to someone else. And basically, who had the same conversation as the first one, really.
All right, yes.
And it was just a complete waste of time. And in the end, I said, OK, well, I'll have a think about it. Now, what I was concerned about was obviously switching networks... And
of
not
course,
get
keeping your own number.
Yes. No, you can keep your own number now. That's no problem at all. But I was worried about switching networks and not getting such good coverage.
Of course.
Yeah. So what I did, John, and you're with EE now. Okay.
Indeed, yes.
I would perhaps suggest that you do this. What I did is I went out and purchased a pay-as-you-go monthly SIM on Three.
Right, yes.
Which
yes.
I think costs... £10, something like that, simply to see how the network was in all the places that I usually go. So I bought this SIM. I had to have a different number, so it was a temporary number. I kept the other number, but I was using this one just for now, right? So
right,
I put the
yeah.
SIM in the car, and then just put the SIM card in the phone, and then just started using it as I would have used the old phone, you know, going from place to work and that, and up to mysticism back. And guess what? Guess what? I actually found the network coverage better than EE.
Well, because sometimes you find with that a network like Free uses the EE... coverage, so they use the masts to actually cover their call.
Well, no, three are a network in their own right. They don't piggyback onto anyone.
Oh.
No, GIFGAF and the People's Operator, Tesco's, Virgin, all those ones, they piggyback onto another operator. But Three is a network operator in its own right. So anyway, so I was very happy with the service. So I then cancelled my EE contract, and I said I wanted to take the number to Three. I then went into a Three shop and said, right, well, I've got this SIM card. I now want to take my number over to you, and you become my provider. And as I say, it was about... I ended up paying... I think £20 a month less than what I was already paying to EE. It costs me £30 a month. Now, that particular tariff I'm on, John, is now £35 a month. I'm still paying
bad.
30. They didn't put the people on the 30. They haven't put our price up. But the contract I've got that's £30 a month is now £35 a month, but worth it, because I get unlimited phone calls, unlimited texts, and unlimited data. Repeat. Unlimited data, yeah.
And which obviously you're streaming on at the moment.
Oh no! I'm on Virgin tonight.
Oh
yeah.
But,
there's no.
When you're doing karaoke, you'll stream on that.
Oh yes, that's karaoke is wireless. While I'm sitting here doing a show, this is all plugged straight into the router with wires. I prefer wires than wireless. And I've been very happy with Three. The other thing with Three is that I had a problem where I found a charge on my phone bill for £10. And I couldn't, I didn't know what it was. And I rung up three. And honestly, they went to the ends of the earth to solve this £10 problem. And what it seems to be is some sort of charity organisation that had taken £10. It, you know, you like you dial a number and you send £10.
On the street, was it?
Something like that. And it was done in December. Now, I remember doing something months and months ago, but certainly not in December. And they thought what had happened is that they'd signed me up to some reoccurring thing. And they, three themselves, contacted the people and demanded a refund for me. And I got the refund. And they, it took them 2 weeks and they carried on and on. So I've been very, very impressed with three. So
Which is amazing.
So I suggest
you
do that.
You guys got the money back. A hundred. You don't normally get them back.
No, 150 quid for a 6S phone on the 3 network. I'd seriously consider that, John. But before you do that, get yourself a little pay-as-you-go SIM for, I don't know what it is, 10 or 15 quid, and just try out the 3 network in all the places you normally go. And if it works, I'd switch.
All right. Anyway, because the reason I'm phoning up is regarding the holiday disasters.
Holiday disasters. Yes, please, John.
Anyway, it was back in round about 2010.
Right.
And I was working in a certain pub in Camden, which will tell you who the people involved could be. Anyway, I ended up going back to this person's flat with their partner there. And we were due to go to a caravan holiday up in Camber Sands.
Oh,
which is a very nice, it's a very nice holiday pub.
Is that Pontins? Anyway,
No, that Pontins, dear, that's too cheap. Camden Park is all.
I used to go to Pontins all the time, I'll have you know. How dare you, too cheap? What a liberty.
Have you been to a Pontins recently? They're terrible. But
I've heard that, yeah. It's a shame, really. They were wonderful places in the 70s, Pontins holidays.
I know. I mean, because anyway, but it was the first time I've been back to Camden Sands for maybe 20, 30 years.
Wow.
I'm showing my age now. But anyway, it was the night before we were due to go away, and this lady invited me back, and her partner was there. We were due to go to a holiday the next day, and unfortunately, I was caught having my fish supper downstairs.
You were what? You had a fish supper?
Yeah, well, I was caught between this certain person's parts, shall I say.
Yes. All right, John. Thank you very much, darling.
Indeed. Sorry. Cheers. Thank you.
Righto. Let's do some of the messages coming in. Hello to Lee. Have you ever actually kept a New Year's resolution? Oh, I don't know, Lee, really. Do you know, I don't think I've really made New Year's resolutions. I'm not sure about that. New Year's resolutions, I don't know. I mean, I do stuff for Lent and usually I'm quite successful with that. Being a little bit religious, I am. I would feel really guilty if I now picked up a bag of crisps. And sort of that helps. But actually, I don't seem to be losing that much weight. Adam says, I want to go to New York. What, now? Are you mad, dear? You don't want to go to New York with that snow coming down at the moment. You're off your head. You stay in front of that nice warm gas fire that you got at home there. All right, 0208 144 3477. Tell me about your holiday disasters. 0208 144 3477. Or you can Skype in on United Kingdom Talk. All right. Hello to Ian Thrussell, who's with us. Ian DJed at one of London's biggest nightclubs for years and years. And he's done courses and passed all the stuff. He's going to be one of those, a juggernaut driver. Yeah, that's fantastic. I hope, Ian, that I could sit in your cab and go for a little drive with you sometime. I quite like that, you know, sitting up there, because I like big vehicles. I do like big vehicles. 020-8144-3477. There's another phone call coming in now. It's Adam the Plumber. Good evening, Adam.
Good evening, Chris. How are you?
Lovely to hear your little voice this evening. How are you, sir? Everything all right in Adam World? Oh, that's gone again. Have I got you?
Say again, sorry.
I got you. Sorry, I thought you dropped out for a moment then.
No, I'm on the iPhone 6, so you'd be safe.
Hello, Adam. Oh, that's excellent news. The iPhone 6. You can't go wrong on an iPhone 6, can you? Eh?
No, no.
Are you on EE? Adam? Is there something going wrong with these phones tonight? He might come back into play.
I'm back in the room, 1, 2, 3.
What are you doing, dear?
Right, no, all it is, the iPhone 6 that I've got, the screen is broken, unfortunately.
Right.
And I've got to get it replaced because the little sensor, when you put the iPhone up against your ear, it cuts the keyboard off. It stops the keyboard from working.
Okay. Oh, okay.
When you got it against your ear. And the little sensor is slightly away from where it should be.
It's working perfectly well now. Can I just try something, Adam? I've just had a thought about what's gone wrong with that other camera. 1 second. Let me see. 1 minute. 1, 2. Oh, I see. Oh, I've got to turn off the microphone on the camera, haven't I? Right, hang on. Let me just see if I can do that.
Okay.
Camera right there. Yeah, hang on.
Oh,
what have I done? Hang on a minute. Hello? That should do it. I reckon that... Can people just tell me, has the echo now gone off the other camera? You may have noticed there's two cameras in full operation tonight. Isn't that exciting?
I can see there are two cameras.
Just move that one round a little bit there. A little bit round the other way. Yeah, I thought it'd be quite nice to have two going today, although I can't get a position of that one right. There we are. That's better. That's gone now. That should not be echoing now, boys and girls. We should have a complete camera. That two cameras now. It just gets better and better, Ian. Adam, better and better, doesn't it? Eh? Anyway, indeed. Carry on.
Yes. I was going to say it'd be nice when you have a camera behind you and we can see behind the scenes.
Oh, I can get one behind me as well. Oh, there's a new one. Logitech had bought, I got an email yesterday, had bought a new camera out. The one I'm using, technical people, is 30 frames per second. The new one is 60 frames per second and it's got a background changer in it.
Oh.
So basically you can have anything behind you. I could be standing in front of St. Paul's Cathedral, dear.
Oh, sounds good.
The Whispering Gallery, Whispering Gallery.
Oh, I'd like to go there again.
Yeah, I've been there in years. I know. What are you calling in about today, Adam?
Holidays. Holiday disasters, yeah. Yes. Went to Rome.
Ciao bella, Roma! Just the luck in your mama used to make it, ciao bella! Yes.
So I went to Rome with my lovely friend Sam, had a lovely time with her, but unfortunately it was spoiled by the locals.
Oh, go on.
Well, you go sort of around Rome and you do all the sort of Colosseum and all the various bits of stone that are in Rome. And
the stone in Rome, I like that. Very poetic, Adam.
Yes, thank you. I'm a poet, didn't I know it? So you go into Rome and you go to the Colosseum and we're stood there sort of looking at the Colosseum for the first time and this man comes up and sort of puts a string around our hand.
Oh, were you being tied up? How exciting. Well, no. Tell us more.
I wish. anyway, so he sort of put the string around us and made in the Italian colours and started telling the story of the Colosseum.
Yes.
And it's all very nice. Anyway, he's finished doing this for all three of us and he's demanded 10 euros.
Oh.
So I thought, well, you know, 10 euros is not a lot of money.
It is a lot of money. It's a pound, dear. A pound is a lot of money. Or is that £10? It's £10, dear.
Yeah,
that is a lot of money.
That funny foreign money that are soon to be disappearing.
Certainly wouldn't spend £10 on a night out.
Anyway, so he sort of got round to sort of saying 10 euros for this band that he's made out of these strings and telling the story. And it's like, well, there's 10 euros. Thank you very much. No. 10 euros each I want.
Oh, right.
It's like... No, you didn't tell me a price. You didn't sort of say you were going to want any money. This is sort of a gesture. It is a gesture for you.
A gesture.
For what you've just done.
I like that word. Gesture.
We like that word. Gesture.
Gesture.
So he sort of, you know, and in the end, he sort of, his friends came over and almost put his hand in my wallet to take the €30.
Oh, really?
So I'm there with Sam and her young daughter, JJ.
Yeah.
And I've just basically turned around to him and said, right, you've got two choices. You can either go away or I'll get that policeman to come over and sort you out.
Good boy. Yeah.
So I was almost ready to push, because he was like on the step, I was almost ready to push off because he was trying to get into my wallet to gain the money.
Well, I don't think you've got much in there anyway, have you, Adam, dear?
No. I know. I'm a poor plumber. So basically that was disaster number one. Right. Then we had in our hotel room, which was about 45 minutes outside of Rome. Not a bad little hotel, but... it was a twin room, and the air conditioning leaked. We put the air conditioning on one night and woke up to a flood in the room.
Oh, my word, yeah. That's quite a regular thing with air conditioning, isn't it?
Yeah, well, they hadn't plumbed the outlet into the... anywhere. It was just sort of dangling under the sink.
It's usually a blocked-up or non-existent pipe, isn't it?
This one had a pipe, but it hadn't been connected. They'd left it there. Strangely enough...
Just slightly changing subject here. I've got air conditioning here, the proper one, you know, on the wall, the two separate units in and out. And I've got a pipe outside. I've never, ever seen it dripping. Why is that? Do you know?
Probably because it's got a pretty dry environment inside, I would imagine.
Not
too familiar with aircon. I mean, do you take the filters out and clean them regularly?
Right. Yes, I do. Yeah.
Give them a quick hoover and give them a quick clean.
Yeah.
I should imagine it's a fairly dry room. It's normally a condensing pipe, so it's obviously...
Oh, is that what it
condenses,
is? Yeah.
I believe that's the way they work. I'm not an aircon expert, but that's how they work.
I think this could be another branch to you, air conditioning. Yeah. I'll send you on a course, dear.
So that was the disaster number two. But they moved us into another room. We were sort of in a basement room.
Yeah,
and they moved us up to the first floor with two separate sort of rooms. So I had a room, and they had a room.
Lovely,
which was nice. So that was that. But I did actually find that most of the Italian people there were there to try and rip you off, but they also have Indian people there. They have a lot of Indian people there selling water, and they've got corner shops and selling selfie sticks, and they were actually the more genuine people.
Yeah. That's funny, isn't it?
They actually genuinely wanted to help you out and things like that. And it's like another one that happened to us as well. We thought when we got to the Colosseum, there was this English tour guide there, spoke perfect English, come from England. He said, you know, we can take you on the three tours of the Colosseum, this and this one, the other two attractions there, which are next door to each other. Mm. So we thought, yeah. So we went on the guided tour, sort of the guide took us around the Colosseum, explained how everything worked, how the staging worked there and everything. And she said, then what you need to do is go out the back, out the exit there, and the next guide will meet you. Well, we got out the back and we'd done the first guide, and I think it cost about £25, this guide, to take us around all three attractions.
Yes.
And the actual ticket for the three attractions was only something like £7, like if you bought the ticket by yourself.
Right, so you employed a guide to do it, though.
Yeah, so you employed a guide, so you get your ticket, you get the queue jumping, so you don't have to queue up for hours,
right?
And you can see the free attraction. Anyway, got out the back of the Colosseum, and there was about 70 of us waiting there, and the guide never turned up.
Oh, Lord.
To take us around the other two attractions, so it was obviously a big con.
Did you go back, or where did you buy this ticket from?
We just carried on walking around the other two attractions by ourselves, sort of thing.
Just put it down to experience, I suppose, really.
Yeah, so if anybody ever goes to Rome, number one, don't use the guides there. They are, you know, you can get your own tickets, or if you know, you can get your own tickets fairly cheaply. Number two, only use the London Sightseeing Tour Bus Company, because you can buy a weekly ticket and hop on and off as you like.
Yes.
And you can also buy a weekly travel card on their tram, train, and underground system.
Oh, that's worth knowing. I mean,
it's very cheap. It's something like, I think it's something for the whole week. It's something like £7, and
yeah,
you can literally go around the whole of Rome on any bus, tram, or underground train.
When we went to Rome, it's a few years ago now.
Mm.
We got ripped off with the minicab from the airport.
Yeah.
And I mean, I say we got ripped off. That's not quite true. But nevertheless, we got off the plane. You know how it is. And there's all these people out there trying to sell their transportation services to you. And instead of going up to a desk, this bloke come up to us. He said, are you looking for transportation to yes, please. He said, I've got lovely transportation for you outside, sir. 60 euros, which is 60 quid.
But
something at the time makes you not think of that. I don't know what it is, the fact that you're on holiday, maybe.
I mean, it's like when we landed, we had to wait over an hour for our transport.
Yeah. So, we didn't wait an hour. This bloke just come up to us in the airport. Yeah. And he looked pretty official. He had something hanging round his neck. And he said, I've got very good, very comfortable car for you. And we went outside and there was a Mercedes. It was a Mercedes, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And it was waiting outside and that was all cool and good and all that business. So we got in the Mercedes and we got there, 60 euros. Well, we probably gave him 65, I think, or 70, I can't remember. And he took us straight to the door and it was all very comfortable and all that. And then on the way home, we were at the airport. We had some time to spare and we saw a sign on the wall which said something like, don't pay any more than 25 euros to a taxi to take you into home. So we kind of got off on that one, really. But it didn't matter. But, you know, if I'd been on my own, then I would you know what I'm like, dear? Cheap as possible, love.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't matter if it's a Mercedes or a Mini, as long as I can get the case in the car.
Now, quick question for you, just changing the subject slightly and going to the next link. Did you turn your stop clock off today?
Yes, I did. No, I did it yesterday. I did something. Maybe I flushed a toilet chain or something like that. Anyway, so I thought I'd wait 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And after 10 minutes, I went out, right, I'll go and have a look now. And I went outside and sure enough, I saw that little black plastic wheel turning slowly. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh. Well, I thought, well, it was 10 minutes now since I flushed a chain.
Right.
I would have thought by now it had filled up. So this wheel was moving around, albeit slowly, quite slowly.
Yep.
Okay.
Mm.
So I then went back to the house and turned the stop clock off, went out to the meter, and it stopped. It completely stopped. So I turned it back on again, and it started moving around slowly. So.
Right.
Next thing I want to do, I mean, whether or not there is water in here going out some sort of outlet pipe that I know something about, I don't know. But tomorrow morning, tonight, I'll fill up the kettle tonight, right? Mm-hmm. I say fill up the kettle, enough for one cup of tea. And tomorrow morning, when I get up, before I use any water, I'll go out and have a look at that meter. Because by then, surely everything will have filled up, you know, overnight. Yes. And nothing will be making it turn around. And if it's not turning around, then I guess that it must be true. Have you seen these little graphs that they send out to customers now?
Yeah, the little they sort of tell you what you're using and, you know, what they think you're using. Yeah,
here it is here. I've got it here. You can't see a screen now, can you?
Yeah, I can see it. I've got you on my other phone.
Oh, you can. Okay. I think there's about a 10-second delay. The delay between when I talk and when you see the program changes depending on the day, how busy the internet traffic is, and all that. But I'll hold the graph up to the screen now, and I'll keep talking.
What you've got there,
the top one, which is green, is the what my efficient neighbours are using, it says.
Okay.
12 meters cubed.
Yep, okay. See that.
Is that a day?
I can't tell from that if it's day or
No, is that 6 months?
Oh, well, 12 months,
12 meters cubed of water don't sound an awful lot to me. Does it you?
I don't know how they work out their
I don't know anyway. Right, so my average neighbours is the yellow one, then it says 25 meters cubed. I am using 36 metres cubed.
Yep.
But the point is, I don't shower here. Very rarely do I use the shower here because I go up to the... When I've been swimming in the morning, that's when I do all my shower and shaving and all that business. The only time that the water gets used is, I suppose, more than anything to flush the toilet, to make tea, and I've got a dishwasher, but they're quite efficient, I gather, dishwashers, aren't they?
Yeah, they're fairly efficient. They do use a fair bit, but...
Okay, and a washing machine...
It's not like you're using it as, you know, everyday sort of thing.
I'm on my own, you know.
Yeah.
Okay, so the washing machine, once a week generally, sometimes twice a week. But generally once a week. The dishwasher, twice a week. That's it. So I find it very difficult.
You're not using a lot of water.
No.
I mean, the best thing I would do is sort of take your own reading and then see how much you use in a week. You know, just do it as you normally would and see how many units you use in a week.
Yeah, I wonder if they've got the wrong numbers. I'd have to look back on my... It would correct itself when they come and do another reading, though, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I suppose.
You just know by your bill. You just know by your bill, won't you?
Tomorrow morning, I'll go out, because I shall probably... I won't be up late tomorrow. I've been waking up... like this morning, I woke up at 5 o'clock again. I did that the day before. And, you know, once you've woken up, you can't get back to sleep. I now get up. It's like I'm like an old person now. Because, you know, they can't sleep at night, the over sort of 65s.
Yeah.
They hardly sleep. My aunt's one of them. She'll be up till like 2 in the morning. Well, she'll drop off at some point and fall asleep for a couple of hours in her chair. Right?
Auntie Brenda.
Yeah, that's right, Auntie Brenda. She'll be up at 4 o'clock in the morning listening to Steve, the excellent Steve Allen on LBC. She'll be listening to him. And, the last couple of nights I've been... Last night I went to bed early, about 12 o'clock. Well, I woke up again at 5 in the morning. So I've now learned there's one. If you can't get back off to sleep, you get up and you have a cup of tea in front of the telly. You watch half hour of telly. Then you go back to bed and you can go to sleep again.
Works, yeah.
Do you know, I'm desperate for a cup of tea now, to be honest.
Maybe I can talk for 10 minutes so I can go and make yourself a cup of tea.
Oh dear. Well, thank you for ringing about your holiday horrors.
Yes, yeah, so if I can talk for another 10 minutes, that'd give me another 10 points towards getting the flights to New York, you see.
Well, they were supposed to be today. Unfortunately they've all been cancelled now.
Never mind. Maybe you can have a whip round for a poor plumber. You know,
that's what we need. A whip round for Adam the plumber, plumbing services and maintenance issues, and soon to be air conditioning specialist.
That's the one.
I tell you what, in my bedroom, I've got one of those wheel around air conditioning things. I mean, you know, to be honest, what do we use that for? 2 weeks of the year?
Yeah, about
you know,
that.
Something like
You've
had
that. It about 20 years, haven't you?
Yeah, well, I have. I've had that. I must have had that thing at least 15 years. And it's great. It's great. When it is a hot summer's day, and of course I sleep in the afternoon, it is wonderful. I mean, it really is. To me, it's worth the money to just have that sitting there for that 2 weeks of the year. Because I can come into that bedroom, I turn it on an hour before I go to bed, and I go into that bedroom and it's just so lovely and cool. And it's wonderful, and it is worth it to me. But when it goes, I'll probably have another proper one put in there, you know, with the fan on the back wall and all that business, like I've got in here. Because this one's quite old in the studio as well now.
That one's probably, let's see, now let me go through the archives. That was probably, hold on, now, I think you had that put in just before the visit of Stacey when you had the green... When you had the green studio.
I think I did.
The green studio. It was just new then.
The one in here is a minimum of 10 years old as well. It's when it was on CMP radio. When it was on CMP radio, that was one of the world's first internet stations. I was on there for a while. And it was while I was on there that I had it installed, yeah.
Mm.
And it's broken down twice, actually. And it's
That's
been the
not
same,
bad in 10 years.
It's been the same thing both times. The infrared eye... stops working for some reason. They come and replace that. It's like 150 quid when they do that. But, you know, it's pointless having it sitting there.
Yeah, it's cheaper
it's
than replacing the actual unit, no doubt.
Yeah, I think so.
I mean, that's the wonderful joy of these shows, you see, Chris. You can always refer back to when you bought things and when you got things. Like when you buy your new kettle, you can rewind the shows and go, oh, I bought the kettle there. It's still in guarantee.
Oh, yeah.
Better than keeping your receipts. Keep the shows. And all you need to do is contact Adam the Plumber, Plumbing and Maintenance Services, to get that information, because I have a font of knowledge of all your shows.
Adam, whenever you've called in, if you want to just put a note on... excuse me, I'm just coughing a bit. If you want to put a note on there, Adam Plumber Services, and your phone number on the... the comments thing. Just put them up there so anyone who ever wants a plumber, London and the South East, then to call you. That's fine. Just do that.
Thank you, Chris.
All right.
Lovely.
You have a lovely evening, Adam.
thanks now, and enjoy the rest of the show.
Cheerio now, sir. Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye-bye.
There we are, the lovely Adam the plumber. Nice lad he is. A couple of messages coming in. John says, note to self, that's John who just called in a little while ago, don't phone when you're drunk. Thank you, John. And he says, need to have some vices during Lent. Gave up the fag, so started an intake of wine. I would like to publicly apologise for lowering the tone of the broadcast. Thank you, John. Your apology is fully accepted and we move on. We don't remember things like that. Don't you worry. You carry on as if nothing's happened, OK? Lee says the microphone thing is sorted as well. So thanks very much for that, Lee. I do like to know when things are working. So if I do that now, then the camera changes, but the sound is still perfect, isn't it? And as usual, it was a tick in a box. A tick in the box. That's what it always is. When something goes wrong, you put a tick in a box and then it all comes back to life again. Isn't that fabulous? 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. Have you got a holiday that went a bit wrong? I mean, it doesn't necessarily have to have gone disastrously wrong. Perhaps just a little bit wrong. Maybe, like me, you're a caravan fanatic now. I love static caravans. Maybe you went on a caravan holiday and no one told you that you have to bring your own towels. No one told you that you have to bring your own tea towels or washing up liquid or something like that. Did you get there? And I mean, the Haven holidays I go on, they always give you sheets and that, I would presume. That generally caravan holidays give you sheets. But what if you've got somewhere, anyone knows sheets? No duvets. You'll have to sleep in your clothes. Anything like that, call in and let us know tonight, OK? 020-8144-3477. 020-8144-3477. All right. Let's have a look here. I think the worst time I got stuck at an airport, that was in 1979. And I was with the scouts on a scout jamboree. And a scout jamboree is when scouts from all over the world get together in a named country. Now, the year we were supposed to go, to Iran, but there was trouble over there. So it was that was cancelled. So the Iran thing was cancelled. Otherwise, I would have ended up going there. And we went to America in the end. And I had a wonderful, wonderful time there. We went to the state of Maine, which is just beautiful. Maine is just like a massive park, really, with great big lakes. And we went canoeing and hiking for 50 miles. We did 50 miles walking and canoeing. Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. And we also stayed on the way there. We stayed at this scout camp called Sabumac. Let me see if I can find that now. I bet it's still there. Sabumac Scout Camp, maybe. Ooh, let's have a look. Camp America. No. March Sabumac. Ooh. Ooh, Sabumac, Maine. Hang on. Is this it? I don't know. Oh, Sabumac Wilderness Campground, the Maine Highlands. Is that it? Moosehead Lake? It could well be that. Sabumac Camps. I don't even know if it's anything to do with the Scouts anymore. Because certainly here in this country, a lot of the Scouts camps and that have been sold off now and they're run by private companies. But this place was called Sabumac. And that was on the way to, I think that was in Maine, but we stayed there before we got to the main place. And I had a wonderful time there. Wonderful. We really were out in the wilderness. We had an American tour guide with us, another scout leader there. And he had his radio, you know, great big aerial coming out from this thing. And every night we would have to call in and say that we were all okay. And he also carried a rifle with, you know, a proper rifle. He had a proper rifle with him because bears, we could run into bears. I mean, honestly, that's what sort of wilderness. We never saw one. I don't think I saw any animals at all. But that's why he was there. And I was 16 years at the time, 1979. What an experience that was. My Uncle Terry, who I lost just a few few weeks ago. I was just talking to my aunt there. Generally now, when an elderly relative loses a partner now, I kind of try and make more contact with them. You know, because it's horrible. I mean, I don't suppose I will. I will never know. I suppose the loss of being married or partnered to someone for 30, 40, 50 years. All my aunts and uncles have been together for a minimum of 35 years now, 35, 45 years, more than that, like my mum and dad was. It doesn't seem to happen much anymore, does it? People are in and out, you know, a couple of weeks sometimes. I was never able to stay with anyone for more than a couple of years. And since 1984, I was married once, and I was with her for about three years, really. And that was probably my longest relationship. Yeah. I don't suppose I'll ever know the feeling of terrible loss when you're with a partner for so many decades and suddenly they're gone. Isn't that a terrible thing? Perhaps you've experienced it yourself. I'm not asking you to call in about that. That's just too painful. I know that. It'd be too painful to talk about something like that. But in a way, I think being on your own sometimes, you are fortunate in a way that you do not have to go through that pain. On the other hand, better to have had someone for that long who really loved you so much than not have had them at all. So I suppose it swings and roundabouts. But nevertheless, you know, as someone... As one of my aunts loses one of their other halves, I then try and start to make a little bit more contact with them, you know, just to make them feel a little bit better. When you lose someone like that, I don't think you ever get over that, you know. I've certainly never got over my mother and father dying. Never got over that. But you have to learn to live with it. You do learn to live with it. That's not to say sometimes you might be doing something and you don't necessarily have to be sitting there on your own. You could be on a bus talking, and then suddenly this dark cloud comes down, you know? And it's very, very painful. But going back to Uncle Terry, yes. Uncle Terry, we weren't a very rich family at all. My Uncle Terry actually paid for me to go on that holiday. Dear Uncle Terry is now up there. You know, I carried his coffin. It was just a few weeks ago now. Uncle Terry's funeral. I carried the coffin and did one of the readings as well. And I'd never carried a coffin before. And you're kind of... there's six of you. So you've got the hearse in front of you and that opens. And Uncle Terry's laying there in the box. And then they kind of pull it out and then you put it on your shoulders. And you would think it would slip off, wouldn't you? But it doesn't. It doesn't. I had a handle near me, so I was desperately hanging onto this handle. And you kind of walk in, and it's, I think it's quite a privilege to do so. It's not eerie. It's not like, oh, don't know about, you know, his dead body yet. You know, it's not like that at all. You actually feel very privileged to be asked to do something like that. Really? Mm, wonderful. Good old Uncle Terry. I've lost a few people recently. Auntie Shirley, she's in Australia. We lost her at the end of last year. So many people, really. Many people. And I actually had, I was adopted years ago when I was from such a young age that I can't even remember, you know, months old. So I was adopted and my mother died in the year 2000. And before she died, I had been in contact with my natural mother, you know, my birth mother. We became good friends. We really did. But that's it was kind of that she wasn't my mother, if you see what I mean. My mother had died in 2000. You know, there's a picture of her. Where do you want to say a picture of my mum? I've got one here somewhere. Oh, well. You've probably seen some of these before. There's a picture of my mum. There we go. All right, that's my mum who brought me up. And she went in 2000. Mwah, didn't you, mum? Eh? And my birth mother, I found It was around about 1985, and we kept in contact as friends. And I never told my real mother until she was on the hospital bed just before she died. She asked me if I'd ever found her, and I said yes. I wish I'd never told her now, really. I thought it might hurt her, you know. I'm not one of these people that goes around saying, oh, I should say what I want and be what I want, and if you don't accept me, then... I think that's just a dreadful attitude to have towards other people who might be hurt just because you think you can say what you want to say at any time of your life. No! But she did ask me, and I answered. I said, yes, Mum, and... we kind of left it like that, really. And then it wasn't long after that I lost her. But I tell you that because last year my birth mother died as well. And I was told by her brother. I'd met the entire family just once, really. That would have been around about 1985, something like that. And they were okay, you know. It was interesting experience, really, meeting all these other people who would have been your, who are, but it's a little bit of a mix-up, really, isn't it? They are your cousins and aunts and uncles, but they aren't. I know all my cousins from my mum who died in 2000. They're my, like, cousins and all that, you know. I know them all very well. And we all love each other fantastically. And here is an entire new group of people who are also your cousins and your aunts and your uncles. And yet you know nothing about them at all. And they know nothing about you. And it is really weird. It's not nasty. It's not horrible. It's just strange. And you don't really know what to say. So my birth mother, Mary, her name was, she died last year. She had a brother, or has a brother, George. And I've met George a couple of times. Of course, the last time was at Mary's funeral. And there we were, really. I turned up at the funeral. Unfortunately, Mary had died. I will refer to Mum Mary as Mary, okay? I always refer to her like that. Except on the phone to her, well, we'll call her Mum because she liked that. And, I got the phone call from George's wife, actually. Christine is her name. And it was, I'm sorry to tell you that Mary had died. She had lung cancer, unfortunately. And she'd gone to hospital. And no one knew, and they'd been trying to call me the night before, but couldn't get an answer. I suppose I was asleep or something, I don't know. But that was told, and then went to funeral, and I was asked to carry the coffin then. But I have a half-brother, Dwayne, who was always... Dwayne didn't have to be... I had to be given away, because that was the time then, you know, in the 60s. You know, not like now. Or you got pregnant, or you'll have to give him away. You know, it was a bit like that then. And Mary didn't want to give me away. Mary didn't want to give me away. But she was kind of forced to, so that's okay. And I don't hold any hardship there at all. I accept that that's how it was. Other people might turn around, oh, how could you do that to me and all that? No, it was a different time then. This is what I can't get with people. They just don't get that it was a different time. It's like this whole racism thing. You know, certain things that were very funny in the 1970s, 1980s would now be, oh, that's really racist. How can you have watched that then and all that old business? That was it then. That's how it was. And I accept that at that time, you know. You couldn't hold on to a baby. You would be scorned at in the street. How could you do that? And I made sure Mary knew that. You know, I made sure, not long ago, really, I felt, you know, just sometime last year, I said, look, you know, what you did is fine. Never, ever think guilt about yourself. Because I was brought up by a wonderful mother and father. Wonderful people. I cannot tell you, and this is no word of lie, I cannot give you one single example of when my mother and father let me down. Not a single example. So went to Mary's funeral, and it was, as I say, it was offered that I would carry the coffin, but my my half brother Dwayne didn't want to do it, and I felt that he should be number one son. Okay, if he didn't want to do it, I felt in my heart that if I did it, that's kind of going ahead of him. And I didn't think that would be the right thing to do. So that's the only reason I refused. I said no to that, because I thought, well, if you're not going to do it, then I shouldn't do it either. You know what I mean? Otherwise, it could be seen as, you know, he's trying to get one over. I didn't want any of that. So the funeral came and went, and that was it. So last year I lost Mary as well. And that it is a very, very strange thing to lose your mum and your birth mum then. It's a kind of two parents, but the weirdest thing ever. So that's the losses at the moment. Anyway, going back to Terry. So Terry paid for me to go on this holiday, and it was all wonderful, wonderful time. After we did the whole trip in Maine, the walking and the canoeing and all that, we went to stay with families. And the first family we stayed in was Boston. It was in Boston. Mr. Faberger, I think his name was Faberger or something like that. It was, and what a lovely family! It was a short man with a moustache, I think, and his wife was lovely. And there were three of us actually, three British scouts who stayed with his family. And you probably know what I'm like with foreign food. And on the first night there, I said, "Well, we're going to have a Chinese tonight," and she was a wonder. She cooked it. No takeout, dear. None of this takeout stuff. And on the very first night, she done us this lovely Chinese meal. And I'd never really seen a proper Chinese meal before, and there was so much of it, honestly. And I ate this meal, and I thought, oh, you know, I can't say anything. I was too polite to say anything, so I just ate it. And a little bit later on, we went to bed. Well, I woke up at night, I was as sick as a dog in the toilet. Oh, it didn't go down too, and I was praying that we wouldn't have Chinese food. I'd never touched it since. You know, it just didn't. There was nothing wrong with it. I was the only one who was sick. I just didn't go down, and I just will not touch foreign food. Rarely. Maybe chili con carne is quite nice without the meat, you know, being vegetarian and all that. But I didn't enjoy that. And the other thing the bloke had, he had CB radios. He had a CB radio. Well, this was blooming wonderful. I loved this thing. I'd never seen it before. A CB radio. And you could pick up this microphone and talk to people that you didn't even know. But this was fantastic. And I was mesmerised by this. Much to the point that I went out and bought two walkie-talkies and bought them back. Loved this CB radio. And they would take us out. I remember going out to a picnic somewhere around by a lake. And went out to a shop to buy a pair of Levi's. You always do that when you go to the States, don't you? And that was a wonderful time. Didn't keep contact, unfortunately, didn't. And then for the third part of the holiday, went to stay with a family in New York. And that didn't quite work out. There was only me and one other boy, I think, in this place in New York. And it just didn't kind of click together properly. You know what I mean? I remember being in the bedroom there, and they had the air conditioning, and it got really cold at one point, and he got up and turned it off. And I remember having a meal, and they had rice, and all of a sudden someone said, "Oh, no one move, I've lost the contact lens." And they were looking through the rice and looking on the floor for this contact lens. It was hilarious. I thought it was funny anyway. And I smoked then. I was 16 years ago and I smoked. And the bloke didn't like that really. You know, I was forever lighting up a cigarette for some reason when I was 16. I don't know why. And as I say, that for some reason, I mean, it was lovely of the family to take me in and all that business. But for some reason, it certainly didn't work as well as it did with the first family. I suppose that happens sometimes, isn't it? You know, sometimes you just don't gel with other people and whatever. Yeah. When we left Maine and we went to this, I think, a scout centre or something like that. And it was like the war, I suppose. We were all lined up and the parents had to come and find us, you know, who it was they were taking home. And apparently at the time, because I thought it was straight at the time, I'd been told that I was going to a family with three girls. I was so excited by that. You know, a 16-year-old boy. Wow, going back with three girls. But that didn't happen. I went, went back with this boy on his own. I can see them coming up to me now, actually, and looking a little bit shy and sheepish. But, you know, thank you very much for taking me in and looking after me all that time ago. I wish I could show the appreciation now that I should have showed then. That was 16, 26, 36, 46. So it's 38 years ago. I mean, maybe the parents aren't there now. I don't know. But what a wonderful experience. Wonderful, wonderful experience. The bad part of the holiday was getting home, because we ended up at this airport. I was on Laker Airways. You remember Laker Airways? They were one of the world's first budget-priced airlines. Now, let me just... I've just got to get the birthdays up, because it's about to become Wednesday, isn't it? I had no intention of doing it. We've done nearly a two-hour show today, but anyway, we'll carry on. So I'll get today's birthdays up. I'm going to do both birthdays at the same time today, okay? Yes, we ended up at the airport, Laker Airways, and it was like something like a 10-hour delay. Oh, God. And again, it's the whole flight. It was the first time I'd been flying. But I don't think it was too bad. We're there in our scout uniforms. We are literally laying on the ground in the airport playing Monopoly and sleeping on the floor in the airport. It's not a nice experience. It really isn't. I mean, I suppose... I mean, do you still get 10-hour delays in that? Do you still get people that get stuck at the airport for 10 hours? Just awful, isn't it? Just horrendous. And that was, I think, probably... the worst holiday on that sort of thing. I've been on a holiday with a couple of friends and that's not worked out. I don't go on holiday with friends anymore. It just doesn't work. I mean, you do end up thinking in the end it's you, right? Because it's happened so many times. One, two, three, four holidays I've had, okay, when I've gone away with a friend, not necessarily the same friend all the time, and it's just ended up in rows. Horrible. And it's horrible because you can't get away. Well, I did actually. I did get away. I came home once. You know, and years later, you laugh at these things. You do. You absolutely laugh. But you know not to do it again. So that's why I now go on holiday on my own. When it does work, if I go on holiday with a family member, either, example, my nephew to Florida a few years ago, my niece and her family to Yorkshire, last year, and my nephew and his family to... was that Yorkshire as well? It was somewhere... No, Norfolk. Norfolk? Yeah, to Norfolk. Went with them to Norfolk. And when I go up to my sister, that all works well. Works very well. Probably because they're younger than me. And therefore I'm kind of... Although I'm as mad as a hatter around children, and I am, the little ones... My great nieces and nephews, mad as a hatter. Although I'm as mad as a hatter around them, you are kind of the responsible airport. You can't cop a strop with children around. Of course you can't. And it works. With family, it works. With friends, when I go on holiday with friends, doesn't work. People have said, oh, you haven't found the right person to go away with. Well, I'm not going to do it again. No, it's more than that. It's five times. I just remembered another one. You can't. No, I'm not coming on holiday with you. It's no use looking at me like that. That's going away with people. That's not going away and meeting up with people for the day. That's a different thing altogether. You know, because I went to New York and I met up with several people there while I was away. The main person being the lovely Suko. Now, If you've been with the show for years, you might remember Suko. We don't hear from her anymore, unfortunately, but she's a dear, dear friend. And I could, if I bumped into her now, I'd pick up straight away where we left off. But she used to do an internet radio show as well, the lovely Suko. And I met up with her, I think, three times in the end in New York. Went over to her house and met her lovely husband. I can't remember his name now. But there goes the clock. It's Wednesday now. Look at that. We've been talking for 2 days. How fantastic is that? How have I managed that? Yes, I went to their house. And then another time we met up and went shopping and I bought loads of bags. You know, because you can buy all these designer bags in New York dirt cheap in comparison to what they are. And I bought all these bags for different people. You know, my niece, my sister and all that. Then again, we met up a third time and we went to dinner. So that was quite nice. And then I went to the Barry Manilow concert and I made some friends at the concert. When you go to Barry Manilow concerts, you make friends with the Manilow girls. If you keep going, you eventually start recognising people. And it's just like one big happy family, the whole Barry Manilow thing. So that was nice as well. But to actually say, OK, let's go away on holiday together and to go to a room and share a room with someone and all that. No, I won't do that again now. No. No, there's been too many disasters. So they're my holiday disasters, OK? And we'll leave it on there. I've got a couple of emails to read you out today, actually. First of all, and this is actually the second email I've had. You remember I spoke about mugs at the beginning of the show today, and we were giving away United Kingdom Talk mugs. There's none left now. They've all gone now, I'm afraid. First of all, Joanna, the lovely Joanna, who's now out of hospital, I'm pleased to tell you, boys and girls. All right, Joanna's now out of hospitals and she's got a few more tests than that, but hopefully all will be well. Her first mug arrived in pieces, completely broken. And I spoke to my sister about it. She said, I'm afraid that does happen sometimes. You've got to wrap them really well to survive sometimes. Her first one arrived in pieces. The second one hasn't arrived. Or at least it hasn't arrived the last time she sent me a message. So I don't know if that one's there yet. But I've got another email here now from Glenda. Hello, Glenda. Who says, good morning, Chris. I've been anxiously awaiting the arrival of my United Kingdom Talk mug. I hope it didn't get lost in the mail. It was so nice of you to spend the money to mail it. So I hope I receive it. You should have got that by now, I reckon, Glenda. So I have a feeling it's got lost in the post. So we've got two unsuccessful sends there. And I'm sorry, Glenda. It definitely went off. Okay, like it went off when I told you it did, so that they all went off. But there are no more left now. I don't think I'm going to get any more mugs done. Generally, sometimes around Christmas time, I'll do something. I don't think it'll be mugs again because they're ending up broken or just don't get there for some reason. Might think of something else this year, okay? So sorry about that. Maybe it will still come, Glenda, I don't know. But I think it's been about 4 weeks now since I sent it off to you, hasn't it? I think someone said sometimes it can take 4 or 5 weeks. So keep your fingers crossed. But apart from that, there aren't any more, I'm afraid. So if it doesn't get there, sorry, darling. But that's the post service for you. All right. Glenda says, how's the weather in England? It's OK at the moment, actually. It's all right. Yeah. I haven't had the heating on for about 3 days, which pleases me immensely to know. To know that my meter is no longer whizzing round, ladies and gentlemen. I'm so happy about that. I don't like to hear my meter going around. I write this in Pennsylvania in the middle of a blizzard. We've already had a foot of snow with several more inches to come, as they have in New York at the moment. We've seen the New York snow clouds, haven't we, pouring down there. I love the show. You seem like a very nice man. Thank you very much. Come to the States. We need more people like you over here from Glenda. I'll tell you what, get me a job on the television over there, Glenda, and I'll happily move over there. I quite fancy a job in television now. What do you reckon, eh? Not just like on YouTube or Facebook Live. Thank you, Glenda. My fingers crossed that you might still get that mug in. All right, darling. Let's have a look. Hello to DJ Crucial, who said, didn't realise your studio was so small. Oh, it's not that big, yeah. Yeah, it's not that big at all in here. It is actually very small. A couple of people have been around here in the past and they think it's like massive in here, but it's not. It is actually quite small in here, my love. All right. John says, I was with my, I was talking about my my mum. I was with my mum on her last night. She knew she was dying. We had a last night together, and before she died, I said, do you want me to wake up my sister? And she said, no. You are with me there. There's £40 in my purse. Go and have a drink on me. Oh, that's nice, isn't it? A nice thing to hear, something like that. My mother, who I lost in 2000, unfortunately, I wasn't with her right at the end. On the last night, I went to see her, and I was only there for a few minutes. And she wasn't really responding to anything I was saying, except to she kept telling me to go. She kept telling me to go, 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 go now, go now. I remember her saying that, go now. So I did, and then I got the phone call while I was at work a little bit later, and the time I got to the hospital, it was too late. So there we are, John. Joanna says it's snowing terribly. I've got about 6 inches of snow today and more coming. Yeah, I know, Joanna. That's why I can't understand. They've told my mate that his plane's going to go tomorrow afternoon at 4 o'clock. Whether or not I suppose, you know, in 24 hours, snow moves quite far, doesn't it? Maybe it'll be over by then. Rosemary says they're having a blizzard here today, Chris. Over a foot of snow, blowing winds, and the calendar says spring on Monday. Well, we got spring here at the moment, to be honest, Rosemary. It's really, really quite warm out there. I've not had any heating on now for 3 days. Very happy about that. Oh, gosh, John. John says, my daughter's stillborn in 1993. Oh, carrying the coffin was the least I could do after my partner carried for 9 months, still in pain. Yes, of course, John. Of course. And you know, John, that you don't get over that. You just learn to live with it. There's nothing you can do but learn to live with it. John was also, in 1989 to 1991, assistant scout leader for a scout troop in North London. The scout leader now is the district commissioner. Oh, they're very important, they aren't they? I'm district commissioner. They're very, very important, they are. Lee says, quick question. I like to come to Central Station Karaoke, but I live in Bracknell, so wondered if there's anywhere to stay for the night nearby. Thanks. What, you... Lee, you live in Bracknell? You live in Bracknell, Lee? And you want to stay somewhere for Central Station Karaoke? What, you want to stay in London for karaoke? What do you mean you live in Bracknell? Where do you live in Bracknell then, Lee? Are you aware of where I am or not? Do you know where I live, Lee? If you're living in Bracknell, do you know where I live? If you want to stay in London, can I recommend Premier Inn? There's two, I think there's actually three of them there. Now, the thing is, if you book early, you'll get a good price. Don't try and come Friday, because you'll end up paying 100 quid or more for a room. But if you can book a few weeks ahead, you'll probably get a room for about 60, 70 quid. All right, at Premier Inn. Very comfortable, quiet. You get telly, lovely bath and shower in those Premier Inns. I was very impressed when I stayed there in November, because that's when I went to Euro Disney, and we stayed at the Premier Inn in King's Cross, and I think it was about £67, something like that, for a night. Very comfortable bed. There's a kettle in there. There's tea bags. If you want to get a meal, I think they've got a restaurant in there. Really, really well done, Premier Inn. Highly recommended, OK? So where in Bracknell are you, Lee? Rosemary says, I only live about an hour from Maine. Beautiful country. Chris, I'm proud to say my husband and I will be married 46 years in April. Oh, that's congratulations, Rosemary. That's wonderful. That is so wonderful. It really is. You're quite right. These young couples today have an argument and they want a divorce. Yes, it's work. Talk about painful, Chris. I just lost my brother, January the 20th. So many people have died in the last year. Just lost my brother on January the 24th this year. May you rest in peace, Rosemary. And still can't talk about him without crying. Of course you can't. Of course you can't. And that will be like that for a long time. Now, you know that. And you will live with it eventually, but... You know, you don't get over these things, Rosemary. I feel guilty. I truly hope time heals. He lived with us for 15 months, had to watch him die and take him off life support. Oh. You see, I've never had to turn a machine off. I mean, I remember the doctor taking me in a room and saying, look, this is the situation with your mum. And then he came back out and he said, well, to buy us some more time, we can put her in a lung machine. I said, what's that? He said, that's it over there. Well, I looked at this machine. Oh, God. And you physically, your entire body goes in this big piece of metal. I mean, can you just imagine the fear of laying in this big piece of bloody metal knowing that you're probably going to die? What is the point of that? That just makes it even worse. So I said, no. I said, no, she's not going in that. What for? Oof. Thank you, Rosemary. Joanna's with us tonight. Joanna, did you ever get the second mug? Because we've got someone else now, Glenda's written in, who said she didn't get her mug either. Just going back on some of your messages here. John says, I've asked Thames Water where my water meter is and they won't tell me. I do live in a flat. They have to tell you, John. How can you have a meter and not know where it is? They have to tell you where the meter is, surely. Thank you to Adam the plumber for inserting his phone number there. If you want a plumber in London and the South East who I promise you will not rip you off, that's the man for you. Just go down the bottom of the messages and you should find it there, OK? Ashley says, grief is a hard thing to get over. It was hard for me and my brothers as we carried my mum from the hearse to the church and into the graveside. Of course it is. Of course it is. Very, very difficult. Joanna hasn't received a mug either. Have to check with the post. I reckon that's been lost as well then, Joanna. I'm sorry, darling. And we're out now. I haven't got any left at all now, I'm afraid. There's no mugs left at all now. They've all gone. I'm not going to get any more done because we have had a little bit of a trouble getting the mugs in. All right, boys and girls. We're going to do today's birthdays now. OK, let's do today's. We'll do yesterday's birthdays first, because yesterday, of course, we started the show yesterday, Tuesday. It's now Wednesday. So Tuesday's birthdays. Happy birthday to Tom Clark, a.k.a. Toilet Tom. He's known as Toilet Tom. He used to work in Belushi's with me. He's a really, really nice lad. Tom Clark, 22 years old yesterday. Happy birthday for you yesterday, Tom. Hope to meet up with you soon. Have you got a girlfriend or are you... you're engaged or anything like that? I know it happens quite young, doesn't it? About 22. I was married at 21, Tom. I was married at 21 and separated at 21 as well, unfortunately. But that's the way it goes, all right. Happy birthday day, Candy Cane. It's Candy Cane's... But hang on a minute. That's another Candy Cane. That looks like another Candy Cane. Is it? Hang on a minute. Is that right? Hang on a minute. Just a minute. Let me just check that. I didn't know I knew two Candy Canes. I thought it was only one. Candy Cane. 1 minute, please. Unless that is... No, it's another Candy Cane. So where are you then, darling? You're in Lincolnshire. Oh, you're in Lincolnshire. Oh, OK. Well, my sister's in Lincolnshire. There's a chat. Would there be any karaoke work in Lincolnshire? If I was to, like, go up there for a few days a week. So if I went up there, like, you know, 3 or 4 days. If I lived in Lincolnshire 3 or 4 days a week and lived in Berkshire for 3 or 4 days a week, is there any... Would I get karaoke work in Lincolnshire? That's the question, or a quiz night. You know, I'd like to know that. Happy birthday, Candy Cane. Christine Frankland, it's her birthday today. Jason Joblin. Yesterday, this is all yesterday. Jason Joblin. Oh, just a minute. Sorry, I've got one there that I'm not sure. I'm not sure she's still with us. Let's have a look. I think it's that one. Yes, it is. Jane Hill's birthday today. Jane Hill was the mother of a good friend of mine. And we lost her a couple of years ago now. So, but it would have been her birthday today. So we still wish people happy birthday if they come up. All right, Jane Hill, happy birthday. Ollie Bell. DJ Ollie. I don't know if you remember Ollie once. We did meet once, long, long time ago. It was at one of those alternative holiday things. I was doing a little bit of comparing and DJing. Now, happy birthday, Ollie. 36 today. Jerry Cashmore Smith, 58 today. Happy birthday, Jerry. Oh, this is yesterday. Sorry, I'm doing yesterday's birthdays at the moment. Petri Trainan. Happy birthday, Petri. Chloe Witt. Hello, Chloe. 15 years old to Chloe. Happy birthday, Chloe. All right. Kevin Hurst, 50 today. Mickey Finn, 49 today. Happy birthday, Mickey. Tanya Sheridan, 112 years old. I'm finding that hard to believe, to be honest, Tanya. Okay. And Cole Bradshaw, there's another birthday for today. Yesterday, happy birthday to you. And today's birthdays as well, we're going to do now, because it's Wednesday now, of course, boys and girls. Unless I do another show today. Will I do another show today? Maybe. What if I don't know? Then I will have missed out the birthdays, won't I? No, I'll do another show today. I'll do another show today as well, okay? So they're Tuesday's birthdays. Here comes the song. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. All right? Oh, you had a wonderful birthday yesterday, boys and girls. Okay, I'll just finish off with a few of your late-in messages. Yes, Joanna says, I understand. Thank you anyway. It was a thought. Yeah, just two mugs I tried to send you, Joanna, and neither of them worked. Next time I do something, it will be unbreakable things. Maybe a mouse mat or something like that I'll do next time. Okay, Joanna. Ray Reynolds, you're with us late, aren't you? Christ, we're nearly... We've been here for 2 hours, dear. 2 hours I've been chatting for today, and you're very late. Fancy coming in the last 2 minutes. Have you been out, you dirty stop-out, honestly? Hello to Ray Reynolds. Is it too late to say good morning this Thursday? It's Wednesday, dear, Wednesday. And Rachel says she keeps losing the link. Don't worry, Rachel, because I'm going to lose you now as well. It's time for me to disappear. Just come back to 12:15. I'm going to have a nice cup of tea and then I'll probably go to bed. So thank you very much for watching and listening to our late night show today. There'll probably be another show tomorrow morning or tomorrow afternoon. More likely tomorrow afternoon, I think. All right. Just give a few more people time to watch this one. I don't know how you find all the time to watch all this rubbish. I really don't. Have a nice sleep, whatever you're doing. And over there in the States, I hope that snow stop soon. I can't bear snow and coldness. I really hate it. And my mate who's going to New York, oh dear, dear. I hope he's got a nice woolen hat to protect those little ears of his. Thanks for watching and listening. I'll see you again later on, all right? Cheerio now.